Here.
Ms. Moore?
Thank you. Public comment on today's agenda items, item number two.
Good afternoon, it's good to come join y'all once again. The only comments I'm gonna make will pertain to item four, other old business C. As y'all probably know, this is Mark's very close Wetzel, 4 years that we've been, when I say we, myself, the Reverend Phillips has been attending these meetings. And I'm specifically referring to legal disciplinary report. And I guess I'm a little taken aback, but so far I haven't seen the first consumer complaint that's been aired here. Which is, I guess, maybe an indication that everybody's doing a great job out there as interior designers. But I can just tell you that I haven't seen that situation on any other board, any other commission. Ms. Dow serves as counsel for the auctioneer's licensing board, as everyone knows, and there's practically no meeting that's gonna transpire at which there's not several complaints. I'm sure Sandy can attest to the number that come through, and I would venture to say that in that 4 years that I've been attending these, I wanna try to make sure I don't overstay here, so I'm gonna say conservatively, no less than 25 hearings have been conducted during that same time span. And yet, well, I'll see that when you think it's less.
Definitely not 25.
Wait, what are you talking about?
Oh. Well, it's 4 years, so that would be 6 a year. All right, she may be right. All right, it's 15 to 20. All right, 15 to 20. That's safe. Well, I can go back and count them. I only got the agenda.
No, we don't need.
No, I don't need it here. I've only got three minutes. But my point is, it does seem to be a board that at least has complaints. In fact, 2 meetings ago, we had one over a $25 dresser. That got quite a few attention of the licensees. But, you know, I would question just what level of protection this board is providing for the public if there's never a complaint. Now, realize y'all went into executive session a couple of times for wrongdoing, so I made public records requests to get to the bottom of that. There's nothing more than that, folk advertising who didn't have licenses, which you might argue was, you know, an element of consumer protection, but apparently you gotta wonder how much expertise is really required for doing this if there's never a complaint that never even needs to be heard by this board. So. That's about it. Y'all probably have noticed I have returned to bring back the camera. I won't go into detail of another board, but I know y'all are more relaxed when I'm up here, so I'm just going to leave it running. I'm going into the break room and enjoy my meal. So I do appreciate. Yes, I can do that. The statute says you have to allow the public board to say anybody's got to stay around with it. But nice run. So hope y'all have an enjoyable meeting. Often, you know, that there's a Chevron station down on government has the best chicken livers, and I love going and getting them. So I'm going to go enjoy them, and y'all enjoy the rest of the meeting.
Thank you.
You're quite welcome.
That concludes public comments today. Approval of minutes from June 25th, 2015. I think everybody has a copy of that in your package. Yeah.
There are copies. What would you
We have a motion to approve the minutes.
A second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Old business chairman's report. I think one of the things I wanted to bring up to the board today is that ASID is putting together legislative history. And of course, they've asked me to try to ramrod getting the information put together. And I realized that after Katrina, a lot of the records that were there are no longer there. And it's surprising to me that also, you know, ASID didn't have these records either. So, you know, in trying to put together this chronology of events on legislation and what was involved in it, I realized that probably we need to kind of all reach out to our own and look in our own archives. You know, particularly those. Basically, I think the thing is, anything that you might have in your archive, and Mary, you've got to have some things.
I've You're right, I probably do. There's a file drawer that got moved to Natchitoches that I don't really look at very much.
And Carol, you certainly do. And maybe just look at your own personal experience, like what your contribution was and what you were involved in, and just email me. Because I'd like to, I've done kind of the cliff notes that I'll send to everybody, which is kind of dates and times and places and things like that. But, you know, I realized when I was looking for the files and they're gone, that, you know, this is an opportunity for us to try to get that information put back together. And I was talking to Heidi this morning, actually, and, you know, Heidi mentioned that a lot of the young designers have no idea how this came to be. And so she's asked me to speak at one of the meetings in October. But I'd like to see if we could all go back and look at our records to see if we have anything in our archives. And I'll send you, like I said, I'll send you all the outline.
That'd be great.
And feel free to jump in any area of it and whatever you've got on it. Because I think this is going to be information that's going to be lost.
I'm wondering if we should strive to print out chronology of the work, the history of that statute, something that we can hand out at our CEUs or at least whenever we have new licensees, that they would have that information. So.
And I also thought, I don't know if this is an appropriate thing for the website, but maybe we could try to solicit information from our licensees via the website.
Yeah. Is this the document that you would like me to send it out to everyone for you?
Please.
With ASID doing all of their odd things with in regards to laws now, is this an innocuous kind of, they're just putting together a timeline?
I think it is. And, you know, they've got new people involved there. And I think they are trying to capture the history.
But they're also requiring it for any state association that wants funding.
Grant
money.
But I think IID is doing the same thing. Heidi told me that she's got to write some kind of...
Oh, yeah, for her grant, she's got to write all kinds of... But it has nothing to do with the history of our bill.
Well, it actually had some other things in mind. Yeah, so I don't know. It sounded like... sort of similar, but not quite as asking as many questions. I'll also, you know, do you have the questionnaire? Can you send them the questionnaire?
What is the questionnaire?
It was the one from ASID having all these questions.
Oh, yeah, I have that too.
So Sandy will send you the questions that they sent out, and then she'll send you my kind of outline response. And then whatever you have in your archives. Try to just go back through. I think it'd be kind of interesting. And then I think maybe can we send something out to the licensees, like an email, or looking for information on... Well, maybe we can get kind of an email together, and I'll send it to you guys to review, and maybe Sandy can send it out to the licensees, because a lot of them have been around a long time and probably have some things in their archive.
Yeah, and once we did put it together, sending a pack out to all the licensees just for information, they can then links to, I'm always surprised how few collections don't have the law.
Right.
Links to those, because remember, this is the law.
I think that would be a good opportunity to get the word out. Mm-hmm.
Just remind people that they don't.
Does anybody should remember NLCID? NLCID, the National Legislative Coalition for Frontier Design Coalition. And it was actually when ASID and IIDA played well together. Mm-hmm. Or not so well, but in any event, it was a joint legislative conference that was held once a year.
Oh, right. Now they have two separate.
I noticed that.
IIDA has done that.
Right, so I don't know. Yeah. All right, well, we'll go ahead and send that out, and then if you guys can go through your archives, because I know Mary and Carolyn, you guys have some stuff.
I will.
Okay. All right. And I don't have anything to update on the NCADQ conference committee. I missed the last call, so I'll try to circle back around on that. I'll get something out to everybody.
Remind you of the date, November?
11th through 17th, I believe.
That's right.
And I have been looking at Frontier Airlines, and Frontier Airlines has been having some $19 sales.
That's a frightening response for 19.
Well, let me say this. My friend Paul was scheduled to fly to Frontier in Denver, which is one of their, you know, he says, yes, it starts out very low. He says, but every time you do anything, they charge a lot for it. So it becomes very much more expensive.
Well, you just have to watch the luggage situation because they charge for luggage.
They charge for luggage and there's something else they charge.
I think they add a couple more fees on it and then they charge. It was like when I was reading something, it was like they charged me for the air. It was basically what the bill was saying.
But you know, for $19, you can do a lot of air.
The official dates are Thursday the 12th is when the pre-conference is in the afternoon. So it's the official conference is the 13th and 14th, Friday and Saturday. The next thing, just to put on the record, is that when the state pays my travel to these conferences, Frontier Airline is not an option. Commission travel has to be booked through state travel if the state's paying for it. If you're flying on your own dime, certainly you can use whatever airline you want, but we as a board cannot book Frontier.
Well, but we're not going as a board. We'd be going
right, I know. I'm just putting that on the record.
Yeah. So that means that the two of us would be going not on our own.
Right.
Right.
Since it's in Atlanta,
it's probably
definitely.
Yeah, probably. Or Southwest. Is Southwest an acceptable?
Sometimes Southwest comes up, sometimes it doesn't. It's through all travel is booked through the contract travel agent, and there's an electronic website that we log into when we have a choose that you book. Which sometimes Southwest, I know I've done this in the past, Southwest was the cheapest, but they weren't on the website. So you have to call and you have to get special approval through state travel. Unfortunately, by the time I got that approval, the rates had changed.
Right, because it changed daily, you know. Yeah. And Shea Steinmetz is still open there, so. That's about all I had. Administrative report, Sam.
Yes, I just want to point out that back in February of this year, you guys invited the licensees to come in and receive their certificates in person. Just to put this in the box, we have 9 so far that live here in Louisiana who have received licenses since February.
Okay.
I don't know if that's something that you guys want to look at doing again sooner than later, or if you want to wait again until. If you want to do it a yearly thing, I don't know what you want to do. It's not really a vote thing. It doesn't cost them a board money or anything. It's just a decision.
When we do this seminar, I mean, you know, the CDU, if you want to do it at the CDU.
Well, we can, except that that's an event that they have to register and pay to attend.
Well, I mean, I didn't know if they were coming, it would be nice to do.
Is it too late to invite them for the next one? We can start doing fall and spring and do.
We can do October.
October 29th.
And then April.
Yeah.
I think we should invite them.
I think we should.
Our next meeting is
October 29th.
We should all.
October 29th.
I like this.
It's also coming costume.
We should dress up really.
Oh, okay.
Ball gowns?
So we would invite all of the licensees that
have received their license.
And then the ones that can come would be the ones
and
probably.
And physically give them. Okay.
So you haven't already mailed any of those?
No.
Did you get a lot of the feedback from the people that we did get the?
Yeah, the people who came and thought it was really nice.
Okay. Well, no, that's nice.
I thought
that was wonderful.
It was. Well, they had their child.
Yeah, right.
I did really like it. Can we put that picture on the website? Photographs we did.
Oh, yeah.
I have the pictures.
Oh, I think I wanted to take it.
So maybe after October, we can put all the new licensees from this year on the website. thought that was nice.
Okay, so I'll send those people invitations, and obviously the people who don't come, their certificates will be available.
Okay, great.
And then, as you know, we're working on the CD, which we'll talk about later in the meeting, and then, believe it or not, it's, I'm already starting to look at renewal forms and what needs to get ready before it can be mailed again. Actually, they'll be mailed before we meet again.
Oh, wow. Already?
Because they go in October. Yeah, I always try to send them out before people get to Thanksgiving and Christmas. So it does, they don't feel like they have another Christmas bill.
Yeah.
So those who want to pay it, meet it down.
There will be those who do it on New Year's Eve.
Absolutely, or CEUs included.
Do we have, Megan talk, do we have a code of conduct or a code of ethics?
For the board?
No, for the, for our.
For licensees.
Yeah.
Just what's in the law.
What's the law, which is.
There's the ethics.
Part of my presentation for ethics.
I'm wondering if we, I don't know what to do with prime law, I guess we might be able to do that in here. But do we put a little checkbox on the thing that says I have read our law?
On all of the applications, it says applicants must read the Louisiana State Board of Examiners of Interior Designer statutes and regulations found on our website prior to completing and submitting this application. Signing this application indicates you've done so and you understand and will comply with our laws and regulations.
It's a long time to get that.
We didn't really have numbers.
They sign it, yeah.
They sign it on our application that they're signing.
The law presumes that you understand the law. You know.
Right.
Kind of like lawyer.
I'm just trying to get more than.
But you are supposed to read it. You are supposed to provide copies of the laws and the regulations to any licensee. Because we have on the website, we're just trying to make sure that they're going to the website to read it. If you have not read our law and regulations, please, please do so. We periodically need to change the look at it, so that's part of what we need to make sure we're up to date.
And that's all that I have.
Legal disciplinary report, Ms. Dow.
Okay, haven't chance, we were looking into a consumer complaint. And I am not, it's a, most of our complaints have to do with unlicensed individuals, you know, performing acts which are licensed or should be licensed. We do in our statute, however, exempt the following people from the requirements of the statute. Specifically, let's see, exemptions. All right. Architects licensed pursuant to 37.41, which means they have to be licensed by the state of Louisiana as an architect. So an unlicensed architect cannot do interior design work. That has actually popped up before. So we do check with Teeny periodically. Engineers licensed pursuant to 37.681 at SEC, which is also, they have to be licensed pursuant to state law. But we also have contractors that are licensed, Louisiana licensed contractors, home builders, and professional home planners. So those in the construction industry, theoretically, who are home builders, are professional home planners. At the time we did that, but that was a specific group of people who were, shall we have it, say, having a discussion with the architects regarding this issue.
Now,
many of our non-licensees are licensed contractors. Now, there's no question you can have both licenses if you wish. I know some of our licensees do. But the question becomes an issue when you have a contractor who is basically doing or practicing interior design. They're exempt from the requirement of licensing. However, they can't call themselves interior design, obviously. And we have a registered interior design that's specifically forbidden by the statute.
Now,
I had a complaint on the office supply house. We've had this before. We have a number of.
I'm sorry, did it say it was home building? Residential contractors?
No. Contractors, any contractor that's licensed. And that brings another issue.
It's different.
But it's not just any kind of a contractor, a general contractor.
No, it says any contractor. Our statute says, and that's part of the problem. But let me tell you what the situation is. The situation is that so we have general office supply houses. They sell all kinds of office supplies, but they also sell, you know, modular units, bronzes. And the issue has been space planning with regard
to the modular
being sold as retail furniture. We have an exemption also saying that if you are just selling furniture, you can talk about the stuff immediately around the furniture, but you can't talk about, you know, the whole room or the whole structure. Okay, so that's how the statute was really originally written, and it's been like that pretty much for the whole time. So the question is, we have a complaint, I looked into it, the office supply house, basically, which will go in there, is selling modular, your cubicles, as I call them.
Yeah.
The cubicle issue, which, by the way, I've noticed that many places I have either worked with or in, they take the cubicles apart and move them anyway. You know, so they're not like something that's fixed.
Oh, no. That's the whole idea.
So it comes across as retail furniture. So my question to the board is, with regard to this, is office supply houses are getting contractor licenses as not general contractors, but there's a series of different kinds of contractors.
Yeah, they have to be a furniture contractor.
Right. So I asked the contractors board. I said, basically, what do you consider that a properly licensed contractor can do? Can they do space planning? Because that was the issue as far as I consider. All right, the attorney, or the director for the licensing board came back for the contractors. Our law does not restrict a contractor from performing such services. However, there may be other laws which require licensure for such services from other agencies, such as the Louisiana State Board of Examiners and Interior Designers, which you represent. So, come back to us. We're exempting all contractors.
Yeah.
Now, there is an issue before the courts, and I don't think it's resolved yet, with regard to all engineers being able to file, you know, with the fire marshal loans. And they're starting to restrict. The court may restrict those engineers. We can come back to some extent and also start talking about that too, because their laws were very similar to that.
Could you do this through rules and regulations? I mean, we're obviously not going to change the law, but can we actually determine the general contractors and the contracting licenses that would be applicable?
Once this case comes down, if it does, we can. That's what I'm talking about. If it doesn't come down, my question to you is, if we're talking about furniture anyway, was basically furniture, another exemption. Is that considered interior design?
No, the furniture itself is not. It's the space planning which affects
egress.
Well, I understand the problem.
Yeah, but can we say that you are not excluded from becoming licensed? Like you can exclude furniture contractors. I mean, we could say that they're not in the law. They're subject to being.
Well, depending on what the court says, we can go along with what the court says. If the court says that we can restrict the classifications that are required for exempt, then that's a different matter.
Why do we have to wait for the court case? I mean, why can't we just say in our rules and regulations that we're not going to accept a furniture contractor as capable of doing space planning?
Because right now we've exempted all of
it's in our law that we've exempted that we are can't go back and not exempt.
Do you have an actual chapter and verse?
I have one.
Can you just read that real quick?
Sure. Exemptions. The provisions of this chapter require persons to be registered and prohibiting unregistered persons from the practice of interior design shall not apply to architects licensed pursuant to 37141, engineers licensed pursuant to 37681, contractors licensed pursuant to 372150.
What is 37?
Wait a minute.
2150. That's the general contractors.
It's a general
contractor. It's all of the contractors' law.
But that's general contractors.
That's all contractors.
I don't think it is. A general contractor is the big guy. It's not general.
They license, I've looked at it.
They have subclassifications.
They have subclassifications.
And a general contractor.
And it requires nothing.
Furniture contractor is one of them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you go look,
it is furniture.
Yeah, that's tons of them.
What's that number?
2150 and 7.
Yeah, just Google it.
Title 37.
You can find the list.
2150. And all the statutes after that regarding licensing.
Well, how hard is it to get into our and change that? Does that have to go to the state?
Well, the problem is we'd have to work it out with contractors first. And that's what I'm talking about. If we're going to go into whether we do it by regulation or by, you know, changing the statute.
So why was that in the original? Just because that's the problem.
Because the contractor showed up and said, we don't want to have to go through your licensing. My problem is that I don't have a problem with that unless they're doing the practice of interior design.
Can you tell us what they were doing, the complaint?
Yeah, they were installing, selling and installing cubicles.
And laying them out, presumably.
Yeah, I didn't go that far into it. The allegation was that they
advertised that they do space planning. They have to do space planning to a degree if they're going to lay out there.
But that's what they do, right?
But remember, we have a statute that says it's a piece of furniture. You can space plan around that furniture without having to have license.
Well, that, it's movable too. Yeah. So
that cubicle furniture, that is considered furniture.
It's furniture.
They sometimes, a company will purchase those modular units so that they don't have to count it as construction costs. It goes into a different category and it gets
right. But there are laws in an FDA that regulate where that furniture should go.
It does. There is.
And aisles and all of that stuff. So it's
right. And ADA too.
And ADA.
But not only is that person doing that, so is every office person doing it.
Most office supply companies.
I mean, you can go into an office. You know, so pick out random ones, and they're gonna have. They did it themselves. So.
What?
Yeah, but
to me, it doesn't matter because it's
you, like sending note like from the design say that we feel.
I mean, I think they're practicing under.
I know they're exempt. And years ago, we sent a letter out to all office supply houses. I think including this one.
I mean, if they're selling interior design services, that's different. But if they're just putting, you know, many of them do their business if they can't space plan it and give me a room and do it. That's what they do.
But they should have a licensed interior designer doing that. Or a licensure.
Most of the office furniture dealers have a license.
They do, but I mean, if you're a small little company, it's not furniture. They got to lay it up. Yeah.
Well, but it's different whether we mind what they're doing versus, I mean, that's one thing, versus whether they're actually breaking our law.
Well, it depends.
Right. If they don't have a license, yeah. I mean, at the moment, they're not because they're licensed contractors.
Right.
So then our more...
In jurisdiction, if somebody wants to complain about them, they can file them very quickly with their license.
That's not a legit complaint is what I'm saying.
Right.
Well, I'm just asking, just why can't we, like two small firms like that, send like a notice saying that you need to make sure that if you are doing these
But they're not doing anything wrong though.
Well, I think they could be.
You need to know what the codes
you
are.
As far as I know, I also sent a request to the fire marshal's office saying, did this group ever send a request for permits? Because is there a permit requirement? No.
Something we can talk to the fire marshal about. That, you know, any kind of large scale furniture workstation layout should be approved by the fire marshal.
But they don't want to do it. I talked to them about that point blank, me to them. At a table, and they don't have enough people to review the construction that they have to take care of, and they don't want to have to be responsible for cubicle curtains, furniture, anything that happens after substantial completion. They wash their hands of.
Unless it's a nursing home or whatever, they have to get, you know, rechecked every year.
Right.
And then those are the ones that comply.
They're not.
Other than that.
Yes, they admitted it is a part of the law. Yes, you can't have, you have to have 12 inches on the push side of the door. You can't put a piece of furniture there. But they're not interested in taking any responsibility for checking that.
Well, I think they do. I just think that there's a limitation as to what they can do.
So how do we enforce our law?
Do we want to nickname those little people like that?
I think it depends. I think it depends on how far they're taking their space planning.
And look,
if they really are just doing furniture.
Wait, here's another instance where.
But if they start taking it upon themselves to be a resource for that client and start with the relaying out some walls and stuff, then we've got an issue. So it would be a case by case basis.
You would have to give us more facts.
Whereas this complaint was just a general.
Which is general, why is this person licensed? Well, technically, the answer is
the company.
But
if they were doing a 5-story building, then I have some.
Can I tell you something?
A little room or something?
Can I tell you something? The same issue came up years ago when a certain person that I know had a contractor's license to do flooring only. But because that contractor license had been issued, that person did the interior design work for a whole hotel.
Mm-hmm. And that's just opening the door.
Yeah, now that's a legit complaint.
That's a different issue.
That's totally different.
We didn't get anywhere with that.
We did?
No, we did not.
No, because he's a general contractor. He's licensed under our law.
It's just a contractor period. Don't even have to be a general.
No, no, yeah, this one's not
just
a
general. Just,
you know. One little test, take it in an hour, you can pass this section, and they have legitimate. Under and around our law.
And that's what I'm talking about. If the court case comes down on the engineering issue,
definitely.
We need to address this because that's a loophole that needs to be closed. Because it's not a good thing for someone who only is licensed as a carpeting contractor to be there specifying furniture and fixtures and everything for our hotel.
So if we went to the general contractors and talked to them about trying to set up this exclusion of the exclusion for certain categories of contractors, and they agreed, what would we do anyway? Put it in rules and regulations?
Mm-hmm. As long as I suppose we have chapter and verse to substantiate it, which
we're not going to do anything without somebody talking to the contractors board. I think this is the executive director who wrote this, so he's aware of the issue. I don't know that they want to. They're like fire marshal. We don't necessarily want to police something that we're not.
Yeah, they're not going to want to get involved. So.
The question is whether they would let us get involved.
So who would we talk to at the contractor board? Obviously not the attorney.
Obviously, but the executive director.
Obviously, we've already got his response.
This is the director of examinations and assessment.
What about the chairman of the board?
Yeah, it would be somebody, the chairman or the director.
Do we know
they're
who
large
that is?
Enough.
We have some folks that would be willing to.
When do we expect the engineers?
You know what, if you're waiting on the courts through, you might as well.
Years. Could be.
I'm not saying that
we can't do it unless this court says it.
I thought you just said if we get the contractor to agree,
no,
we can
you
do
talk to the contractors.
I don't think they will.
I don't know, you know, basically.
They're not going to. I would think that they would be in favor of limiting anything.
Yeah, you have to
restricting anything.
It can't hurt to ask.
No, I think we need to do that anymore because it's the right thing. You know, it's like the right thing.
I mean, to be on record that we did. At least try to put
that in the contract.
So can't tell without trying.
Yeah. It's still a problem with like keeping, you know, we need to keep our relationship.
Do you know the details on that complaint? Like what they were doing?
No,
was it
no,
small,
there were no details.
The large office?
No, there were no, it was just, it could do a, you know, a 5-story building someday, but I don't know that that's going to happen, or even whether this company would agree to do that without bringing in a professional. Because there was a certain amount of liability involved when you do that, and some business owners would realize that it is silly for them to assume responsibility for something that their insurance doesn't cover.
The executive director's name is Michael
McDuffie.
Yeah,
okay.
Michael, and he
and that's the executive director?
Yes.
The general contractor's licensing examination is quite extensive. So you would expect that if a general contractor was licensed, then the breadth of their knowledge would give them at least a familiarity with code issues and that sort of thing.
Right.
But these little individual subcontractor licenses are nowhere near like that. That's what I came up against and just hit a brick wall.
Well, and let me say this. I'm not sure, you know, we need to establish a relationship with contractors for a number of things, including, you know, if there's an issue with a contractor who is practicing tier inside or hiding behind an exemption, the contractor's board may not want to get involved. They may let us enforce that or at least look into it to define what they're doing correctly. I don't think that those little small exams are due for each individual subspecialty would cover a lot of code issues.
No.
And you know, on one hand, I agree with Karen that it depends on the scale and what they're actually up to. But the only way you can quantify it is either by square footage, like the state fire marshal does, or by
dollar value.
Well, the thing is,
I'm not both.
And yet, the truth is that you can have a small room and equally as
dangerous.
Yeah. But anyway,
well,
but that's the only way I can think of.
There was this argument about $25 compared to the other option. That's not true. In any event, I don't look at them as the size as much as the quality of the work done. Because, yeah, one person dies in a small fire, still dead.
And maybe you could quantify it by effect of the life safety code, you know.
Well, anyway, this was a general complaint about, you know, why isn't this person licensed? I'm going to have to answer that complaint by saying, because they're exempt. But I would like the board to at least address this, you know, knowledge information question with the
board. Could you get the fire marshal involved on it if you explain the situation? But he would not do that.
I think I already tried.
We had a 2-year period, and they had done this in the past too. There was a liaison committee formed by the fire marshal's office to facilitate communication between all the building environment personnel. So we had engineers at the table, architects at the table. I was delegated, because I was president of ASID South Central at the time, to be interior designer. And Dan Molyneux went on occasion with me at the time. So that was when that opportunity, I had all those people sitting at that table. That has been about 5 years ago.
Although there are two things in play. One is the plan review process, and I can understand where they might not want to do it during plan review. But there's also inspections after occupancy. You know, they can call a safety inspection on their own afterwards. And maybe that's the approach to do it. I can understand they don't want to review the plans. But, you know, if you...
Well, Karen said they would do that on a health care situation where they're going to be re-inspecting those facilities all the time.
Yeah.
But I suppose all we can do is ask, or at least present them with this dilemma and that make them aware that this is an issue that's going on out in the real world, and what are they willing, or what is their...
Because the fire marshal, they catch a lot of that. Because a lot of buildings act like this one, they have to go in and check the sprinkler, make sure the tags are right, all that. So they catch those kind of things. But a small office or something like that, they don't have to really do it.
And again, as you well know.
And maybe they don't need to. If it's small
Owner can go in and say, I don't like the way this is, so let me move it.
Yes.
And then violate it. Yeah.
And right, after that person's gone, the owner might move it and mess it up. So you don't know who's responsible.
Well, if their plans, original plans, you can always use that.
Right.
They've got to have some kind of installed layout.
9 times out of 10, you never find out
yet. That's probably true. Okay, so we got a couple of things that we take for homework.
Let's just put it there.
It's a sticky situation. That's why I say it. Something small, we don't even want
it. Well, that's why I'm bringing it to you, because, you know.
Define small, you see what I'm saying?
That's why I have questions. We don't know.
Well, yeah. And a lot of times.
It'd be nice to have that information. What was it? What were they doing? can't even comment because I don't have information.
That's a good point. A lot of times, phone calls come like that. You have, you know, it's a furniture or a, however they want to classify different categories of people, but they don't give you locations of where the work done was done, the time frame of where the work's done.
So we can't even comment on it.
We have to, I don't know, public records request every single thing from the state fire marshal's office that has permits pulled, and then we have to look at every single one to determine what's in the design.
Don't ever permit the fire.
Oh, the fire marshal will tell you, that's one of the major issues he has, because it fires quite often, is the furniture or the fabric or whatever, upholstery, that causes the damage or even death.
Blocks the egress. Worthwhile having a conversation with Butch, I think we talked to him just.
Well, he said at one of our meetings that buildings burn today faster than they ever have before, and it's because of the interior finishes that catch fire and people die from the chemicals that they're emitting before they die from the flames.
Right, and the finishes should be part of the review package, at least initially.
I have never, ever had anybody check fabric or anything they come on site. Y'all ever had that?
No, never, never, ever.
There's specific requirements for those things, especially.
Yeah, and there'll be the specifications, but nobody checks them.
No, but that's the question I have to the fire marshal. Whose responsibility is that?
The fire marshal.
We don't have the personnel.
Yes, it's an issue, but we don't have the personnel.
I'll take care of it. She just writes, you know, that little exemption.
But I think we should at least talk to the general contractors.
But the person complaining, I mean, if they want to give us more information and detail.
That's what I meant.
Well, no, if I get a specific event, you know, a building that's being done, and we've turned those over to the contractors board, or a couple of cases to the architects board where we learned that they were violating their statutes. They have more investigators, they have more money than we do.
Yeah, and they can take hands on it.
But, especially if we had a hotel like that.
Well, it's their licensees though, so.
Right.
They should investigate.
Correct. And that's part of the theory also behind this, because if you are a contractor, you are subject to their rules, and if you violate those rules in some fashion, then they can take away your license.
So we need to revisit this again.
Yeah, I think we should.
I'll make a couple of calls coming out the next meeting, maybe we'll get something out before the meeting so we can talk about it again.
All right. That's fine.
Oh, okay. New business, budget report.
Can you pack it? It's a brand new year, so we're way under budget.
We like that percentage.
And income also.
Yes.
Right. But since it is new year, I mean, it all looks normal.
Mm-hmm. Anything you need to point out specifically on this, Drew?
I don't think so. Okay. It all, we fixed the budget for those bank charges, the credit card charges and everything that were due last year. So I think everything should be trending more regularly.
Yeah, and honestly, I'm going to say, there, I don't know when something will be spent that's not in the budget, because that would be not okay for me to do. Mm-hmm. So we're not going to come to a meeting ever and point out that it's gone over.
Right, but you might, like, you might have a situation where the income didn't match the target.
Well, we're going to get so far from you.
So we're ahead of schedule.
July 1st.
Yeah, you see, like, insurance is a high percentage that just happens to be because insurance was due.
Right,
at the new year. So.
One time for the year, it's done.
All right, so do we have a motion to approve the budget?
I say move.
Second?
I'll second.
Any more discussion on the budget? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Drew. Review of applications for interior designer status. Mary Gilmore, Rebecca Trudy, and Charlotte Group.
Yes, we have Mary Gilmore. She works for John T. Campo and Associates. And I'm quite sure she's one of your neighbors. She's not in your building.
Okay.
She went to the University of Cincinnati, and everything is in order and we're fine. And then we also have Rebecca Truding. She works for AGL Commercial Interiors, which is Mita Ligio here in Metairie. And she went to LSU. Everything's in order in her file also, which means proof of NCIDQ, transcripts, everything. Charlotte, also for her, sorry. Everything is in order for her also. She works for CDM Smith, another one of the Poitras Street neighbors. And she went to Tulane. She has a master's in architecture. So we'll get that one as much as we can.
Thank you.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead and check on it.
Deb and Carolyn sit next door.
So we have three applications.
I have two, so.
Just so she's all right. Yeah, she assured me she's in.
Okay. All right, so we have applications for Mary Gilmore, Rebecca Truding, and Charlotte Truth. Do I have a motion to approve all three?
I'll second.
Any more discussion on these? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Did you notice the way the ladies?
Well, the architecture degree is now separated into a 4-year degree that's a bachelor's and a 1-year that gives them a master's. So almost every program that they
get a
master's degree.
Yeah, in 5 years.
In 5 years.
I don't think you can sit.
It's always been
one,
though.
Fifth year.
No, it hasn't, because Tulane used to give just an architecture degree, and the guys that in my office that got that degree, subsequent, just the last few years, Tulane sent them the master's, the piece of paper that says you earned a master's. In today's world, they earned a master's.
Right.
Wow. Because see, when Rob graduated, he went 5 years to get a bachelor's.
Right.
Because you had to go 5 years. That's what I was thinking.
Right. It was 5 years.
But you didn't mention that.
Is
that at LSU too now?
That's the question. NCIDQ report?
Well, I haven't received any information from you, other than that the conference is. Right, and I put this on the agenda, not to put you on the spot, just to see if you had anything that you wanted to discuss from your conference calls, which you said in the meetings. We don't have anything to say.
Right, and I haven't seen anything additional to that, and I will go check the website.
It's just coming. It's November. They eliminated those. Don't you guys remember?
Yeah.
A vote or a poll straw at the last conference, and we're asking how valuable are they? Do you get anything out of it? Is it worth your time? Whatever. And the delegates overwhelmingly decided that they did not want to do those calls any longer. So they send out. I've checked my. There's a page, my NCIDQ. And there's a place for delegates, and I've checked that within the last few weeks, month anyway, and there was nothing that had been posted there at all. So they sent to me as the administrator, there's been nothing of substantialness to report, but just like a
so
QE for board administrators. That's what the annual conference is for.
So once a year.
Which honestly, well, the two of you as being the delegates and myself have access to QLink and all the minutes from the board meetings from their executive board are on there.
Right.
So that's how we can stay up with what's going on without having to have a call to do it. You can just read it on your own time.
I know they just recently had a board meeting, so maybe at the next meeting we can look at the minutes.
We could at least report on what happened at the
Because I know they were just
I'll make them in.
I think the only alerts I get from them are so-and-so is now a delegate. Welcome her. And then everyone sends all these welcomes. That's great.
Because the NCIDQ communication is now set up like Facebook, so if anybody replies, you get it all. Yeah, it's like a whole social media network.
I was like, oh,
and it's and you earn points for how often you are on QLink. And how often you chat or participate, whatever, and at the bottom it shows you who is winning as far as earning points.
So that's why some people are very on their own.
You'd be happy to know I'm not leading the pack, because that, to me, that's not a main focus of my job.
Right.
Is playing on NCIDP Facebook.
Okay, so that's all for NCIDQ CEU report, fall CEU.
Okay, we do need to talk about that for sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you need to tell you what we have so far is, I just kind of wrote it out in a calendar. Let me come sit by you, Karen. Yeah, you can do that. Everybody has them in their packets already.
Okay, cool.
Well, you guys know that you decided that Anna was going to provide 2 hours worth of ethics training.
Yes.
And then Drew found Reagan, is it Reagan?
Mm-hmm.
O'Toole from Herman Miller is going to do a course in Baton Rouge on Friday, which Drew said she could most likely do in Shreveport on Saturday. And then, so that leaves us 2 additional hours that we need to fill at each venue. So I have a couple of things out that I'm still waiting on people to check schedules on. I have the card that Marion gave us from the, what was it, Timber Blonde.
Yeah.
A woman named Bianca, who is their CEU provider. She just has been out of the country and she's playing catch up. But she said she was gonna check her schedule and get back with me. And then T.L., I don't know why I'm pointing because she's not sitting there. But T.L. recommended Roger Gooch, who is the district or regional or something for Forbo. And she said that he used to come to LSU regularly. And he had been great.
Yes.
Okay, so I contacted Roger, and he's absolutely, I would love to come. Let me just check my schedule and get back with you. And that was just 2 days ago.
Okay, good.
So
because that would be a really good one.
Are you going to go on these slots?
Yes. Now the question is, I don't know if they can be Baton Rouge and Shreveport.
Yes.
So I just kind of have to wait.
Well, maybe Baton.
Well,
maybe
the thing that
I could do Shreveport, you know, vice versa.
Well,
we need two
hours.
Heidi, I had a conversation. I had an opportunity to have a face-to-face conversation with Heidi, and her comment was, we might be able to do some of the ones that Elsa did, or one or two. In Shreveport, they could be different. The Baton Rouge
can
ones.
Can you reps up there in Shreveport? You could
yeah.
call that, which it would be nice, you know. So
because
right.
the people in Shreveport would most likely not have been attending the LSU.
Well,
one.
And honestly, the people who went to the LSID CEU in May, they're not coming to our event
right,
because they've already in got October anyways, because they've already got it. So.
All
of any
of
this
would be
any of this could be repeated.
One of, there's Nanowall. I thought that was a good one. There's one on color. That would be a good, you know, healthcare design too.
Yeah,
the color. I think most of the Shreveport reps are out of Dallas.
Yeah,
they
Texas.
Are.
Oh, but most definitely. But now I'll tell you, the Shreveport ASID group is very good at getting 1 hour lunch CEUs, and they come from Dallas.
Yeah.
They were just invited.
And we wouldn't want to have in our day something that they recently had at one of their lunch meetings.
That's right.
Right.
So
yeah.
So
yeah.
Really,
yeah.
need to coordinate with what they. Cause I,
yeah. And they
yeah,
have had this Timberline and Shreveport.
Would you reach
that's
out
what
to
I got in a car. But there are other things on here.
Yes.
And if they were trying to fill
so,
out, but.
You know also
that wasn't all licensed, that was just ASID.
So we need to make sure that we contact the Shreveport.
I'll talk to Jennifer.
If you would mind doing
no, not wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the state fire marshal might provide somebody for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So
right here in Baton Rouge.
Yeah.
Certainly in Baton Rouge, and maybe even in Shreveport, I don't know.
Because
they have CAM seminars that they've been having all over the state.
Mm-hmm. Probably not, maybe not on a Saturday.
But is that going to fit in with the other things that we? That
well,
we,
it's a little bit of a jigsaw puzzle. I do recognize that because there are 2 locations and
yeah.
lots, but we can work it out.
We could also reach out to the Mohawk rep. They actually have a LEED certified person at the factory that does.
Oh,
I'm sure all of
those. Well, somebody said something about Charlie yet. Now, who is that? What is Charlie?
That's the interface. Right. Now, I haven't contacted Charlie. I know Charlie, but I haven't contacted him yet simply because I have two people who said, yeah,
they're
hiring.
They got to give us something.
Absolutely. But that was just this week. So yeah. I'm going to give them, you know, just a couple more days and then we'll move on. But definitely, I've got Charlie. I also know, which Tia had put this in her email to Michael, who is, he's designing a lot of the carpets now at Shaw. He's in Atlanta, but he's from here, so I don't know if he, you know, has the, I see him go to China and Hong Kong.
Did we get comments back from the LCID people? I mean, when LCID attended these, did we get any comments back?
Which seminar was worthy?
I think it was a good day. No, I think everyone enjoyed. Well,
which ones of these would you say stood out as being valuable or interesting?
The paint one was good, I thought, especially the effects in the green building as far as having good content. I don't think the operable glass would be HSW. And then
how about the color one? Because only because that seems to keep coming up, you know.
Operable glass is HSW according to IDCEC. Otherwise, we wouldn't have done it. And I left them all up on the IDCEC website.
Oh, right. Okay, you already had that. Okay.
Yeah.
Because they're one inch glass, you know, so they're energy efficient.
The content was good. The guy was a little bit funny and made it interesting. He was also a little bit nervous. Karen, I don't know if she covers for PPG. I don't know if she covers for Louisiana, but she is. She's a great. She adds a lot of humor and is a great.
And that's the color one. Color.
Yeah, she did both. She did the.
I'm sorry. Which two did she do? Oh, I see them in a row.
Yep.
Here they are. Okay. And her name is Karen.
Karen Favre. I don't know if she covers Northern Louisiana. Because she lives in Mississippi, so.
Or whether she'd want to do 2 days in a row.
And then Big Ass Solutions is just funny.
Yeah, it's just funny.
It's good. It was good information about air movement and how to better move it, really, especially with all the air pressure coming from above, staying above.
Well, which ones would you just, if you put them in order of good, you know, good, better, best, would you do the Karen ones? Would you rate them higher?
I would rate them higher because I think they draw more interest.
That's what
would be my
impression.
Then probably Big Ass Fans, and then Apple, and then Glass.
The glass walls would be more of a niche, not just a
niche.
Yeah.
I think paint with
Karen
Fowler
would be good.
We're waiting to hear from Roger Gooch with Forbo and Bianca. Timber blinds.
So that was more window treatments because that had come up that people wanted to see, but they also wanted the floor. So I'm hoping that the Harbo that might come out.
Yeah, so I'll give them just, you know, a little more time, and if they can't work it out, then I'll just kind of close off with them and move on to Michael with Shaw and these people.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll contact Jennifer up in North Louisiana and ask her about reps that live up in that area.
Or CEUs that they've done in the past year at their lunch and learn. So that
they just did paint. I know they did something like 2 days in a row, with the meeting and the next day with the architects on. I think PBG might have done one of them, I'm not sure.
Want to duplicate what they've already done.
What's the date again, Sam?
Friday, October 9th, and Saturday the 10th.
Yeah, this is a 4 week.
consider reaching out to the state fire marshal for now?
If she can't find them.
Yeah, they can definitely, they'll be down.
They'll put it down there, yeah.
They're on the list.
Nobody wants to do that again.
Just gonna be an embarrassing thing.
Yes.
And I know that one of their plan reviewers talks about ADA and some other things that designers might be interested in.
Yeah, there are things other than code that we talked about.
Right, no, they've got quite a few canned.
Yeah, and they may be doing something, I'm just on that. You need to get somebody knows them, credit, but going to a state line.
Well, they usually hold them someplace in North Louisiana and then you got.
Right.
They come around there.
Yeah.
Once a year.
Mm-hmm.
They just had one.
Mm-hmm.
About two.
I think it does good to foster our relationships.
Yeah, and I found it one of the years ago in Dallas was really very informative.
Yeah, that was good.
It wasn't boring. I didn't find it boring at all. They talked about what they did, how they did it, and what they were looking for.
They've got a lot they can talk about for now.
And at the last meeting, I was pointing out that you guys already gave approval for this CEU to include 2 hours of ethics and 3 hours of HSW content to be provided by manufacturers. So I think we can move forward with this. And you guys have already approved all the fire marshal CEUs, so I don't think we need a vote or
we just need to order.
You can fill it in as a count.
Very sophisticated.
Your spreadsheet?
Yeah, it's my spreadsheet. That's what I thought. Because, you know,
because
between the office and working at my home office, if they call and I'm not pulled up on the computer at that exact moment, I pull it out and, I've got it in my little
good old paper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let us know what you come up with.
Yes,
just let us know. But we trust you to work out the things.
Okay. And I'll keep you in.
It'll be nice.
And the rest
of
us have this other person calling.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I think
that kind of like wakes you out.
Absolutely. I think that that's going to make a big difference for the licensees. I think that they'll see that the 5 hours goes by much faster.
Oh, yeah.
Listening to four people.
And we're having it at the Gonzales.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, same place we were.
And where do we have it at Shreveport?
At the courtyard. We have it at Courtyard Marriott in Bossier.
Oh.
Which is our normal.
Yeah,
is it?
That's our normal spot.
Now, do we normally come up with a name or something, or it just says, I'll see you?
Well, we put the title of the class. So normally we've had Donna before, and she's done like three different classes, so people are used to it being not just one topic for the whole time.
I know, I think we could come up with some little blurb or something to say that we're, to kind of say what you just said, something that will keep it moving.
Well,
you know, but in other
definitely,
words,
it will be out there as, you know, four topics,
yeah,
four different speakers.
Go.
Get all of your hours done in one day.
Exactly. Get it all done, interesting, whatever.
Yeah.
Right.
But
yeah.
We're not doing it as mix and match, right? We're not doing like 1 hour. And
no, it's day.
It's all of it.
It's too difficult.
People coming and going.
And
then one speaker runs over and one finishes early or, whatever.
And I don't think that will matter to a few folks who maybe have had one. Just for instance, the Timberline thing. I mean, it would be interesting to hear it again. You don't get it all. It was only 1 hour. It was fast. So it wouldn't be too bad.
It's only 1 hour.
It's usually 1 hour again and get 4 hours together. You can't get credit for it, but for 1 hour.
So that's it.
Okay, our next meeting.
October 29th.
October 29th.
Do we have a motion to adjourn?
I'm a. I said.
Well, we don't need to.